I'm gonna fall into the clutches of this spiritual dualist, pretender, and I'm gonna be brutalized and enslaved. So, really, that too is all part of the mix. That too is part of the challenge. If these spiritual madmen had not come upon the scene, we wouldn't have been challenged so badly. I was challenged so badly. I was literally like life and death. I said, I have to study A Course in Miracles. I have to get this. I have to. Otherwise, my mind is just, I'm going to be enslaved. It's horrible. Because the attraction of spiritual rhetoric and spiritual posing, this hanging loose, resting freely, posing, was so potent. It was like irresistible almost. But A Course in Miracles enabled me to resist it. I said, no, Jesus knows the way. I have complete trust in Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Jesus is giving us this material to study and to absorb and assimilate. So I am going to do that because I know that He is truly, without any continuity fear, is truly free. There's no deception in Jesus whatsoever. So I knew that this was going to help. And then again, Journey Beyond Words also, I knew this would help. It's just a matter of doing it and doing it and doing it and not paying attention to the spiritual madness out there in the world. There's so much of it. There are so many posers who took advantage of this temporary confusion of the West, to exploit the West, to exploit their devotees, because they could do the song and dance of hanging loosely and relaxing freely, you know. And we are being in this uptight corporate reified cage, mental reification, that is America, that is the West, that is materiality. We were like desperate. And so we see someone posing as hanging freely and relaxing and resting freely and hanging loosely in the now, supposedly, with all the spiritual rhetoric and paraphernalia. It's just like, you know, could hardly resist, And of course the cities and the light and the miracles and blah, 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 blah. We think, oh my gosh, this is so much better than this uptight corporate culture, you know. At the same time, we realize that something isn't quite right. Something isn't quite right, though. You know, that's, Holy Spirit made that very clear to me. Something isn't quite right here. And this could get very dangerous for me, you know. But at the same moment, same time, we're super attracted because we're desperate to get out of the straitjacket that is coming. So we had this thing set up. We knew this materialistic, secular materialistic, high-tech monstrosity is coming. We had this infusion of the high teachings of Tibet and India getting mixed up because we weren't ready for it. And so we just had this confused, challenging time, really. Very confusing, very challenging time. So I'm exceedingly grateful that Longchenpa showed up, which is an exceedingly good sign for us. That means we in the West are now capable of receiving the true transmission, and that in 2013, it just so happened that this book is made available, which is for me is the most potent book I've ever come across. It is extraordinarily potent. We don't need to compare it, really. Let me just say it is extraordinarily potent, and it is no question is a fourth phase teaching. As I call it, I say there's five phases, really. Not seven, but I just say five, really. Okay. This is the fourth phase, and this is extraordinarily helpful. So that's a very good indication. Extraordinarily good indication that the work that Jesus Christ has done in phase 1, 2, and 3, knowing the goal of phase 5, understanding the overall picture, has been successful, has been very helpful and successful, at least since I was able to do it. That means it is very doable. It is very, the support is there. The support is there. So we are not forsaken. We were so truly, we've been truly challenged and continue to be truly challenged. But do not shirk away from the challenge. Yes, the intensity of it was simply crazy. Crazy intensity, really. Intensity was so crazy. I was just like, wow, this is intriguing. How could a situation possibly be so intense? So, unfortunately, we do get put through that challenge, trial by fire like that, the intensity. And but you get stronger, you see. You don't quit. You get stronger. And without the support for me of the phase 2, 1, 2, and 3 Bible Course in Miracles, Journey, My Words, I couldn't have made it. I could not have made it. No way. And you could maybe use other teachings of phase 2, phase 3. It's possible. Sure, sure. But here in the West, we were truly, truly badly trapped. And we were like incompetent in terms of being able to deal with these higher teachings, and very vulnerable to those spiritual dualists who know how to manipulate those who are confused. But not so vulnerable anymore. Now, before I did this taping, there was this fly that was ear, nose, eyes, bugging the heck out of me. And I kind of swatted at it. I don't like to kill anything at all, including all insects, whatever. I said, but fly, I can't do this taping with you constantly bothering me. And I do talk to insects that way, and I convey a vocus. I said, look, let's work this out. You're bugging me. I don't want to be bugged. I said, I'll tell you what, fly. I looked around. I found a plastic container. I said, you land somewhere and stay put, and I'm going to put this plastic container over you, and I'm going to save your life, save myself from taking your life. Let's work together on this. And the fly did that. I've done that with flies, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of insects and whatever animals. They listen. There's a consciousness. All is consciousness. There is conscious intelligence. There is an intelligence there, I've found. I have amazing experiences. And they say, okay, yeah, I just want to get outside. I just can't help it. But could you help me? Sure. I catch him. I put him outside. Where someone else, they can't catch him. The fly won't stop. The fly will come right up to me and land right in my hand or something. And then I put the plastic container over it and take him outside. So there is a little fly in here. There it is. Okay. And there, you see it's moving around. There, you got it. And it's just hanging out in this little plastic container so I could do this taping. Okay. Now, this is very symbolic. It is like those dualistic spiritual madmen who are posing to be so hanging loosely and resting freely in the now with all the pomp and circumstance and that tricked us so badly, challenged us so badly, bugged us so badly. What I did was I just put him in this little container, like a fly, and I said, hey, I'm not going to attack you, kill you, destroy you, whatever. Just going to put you over there so you can't bug me anymore, you know what I mean, like that. I'm not going to interact with you, I'm not going to argue with you, I'm not going to dialogue, I'm not going to read your books, I'm not going to watch videos, movies, you know, whatever you got, I'm not going to have anything to do with you, you see. But I'm not going to lead a crusade against you either, you see. I got better stuff to do than lead a crusade against you. I'm not going to spend all this time swatting you away. No, I'm going to, okay, you're going to be put in this little glass container, so to speak. and that way I was able to then focus on what needed to be focused on. So do not engage these spiritual dualists. Do not engage them. Do not lead a crusade against them. Do not lead a crusade against this entire spiritual dualistic bureaucracy. That will cause you severe troubles. And ultimately failure. What we have to do is keep our attention on what is truly liberating, what is truly enlightening, truly liberating. The true wisdom. Phase 1, 2, 3, and 4 that are coming from the true sources. Okay, the true source of all-knowing, pure clarity. Keep our attention on that at all costs. And do not lead a crusade, or do not get caught up in a crusade. Both, all right? So, I certainly point out the troubles of this bureaucracy, but only to tell you how important it is to detach from it, how important it is to turn your attention away from it. And I believe that we have done this here. How important it is to not get caught up in the superficial attractiveness of it, which it can certainly put on an attractive display, can it not? It's like this, it's like leading a crusade to liberate us from darkness. You know, that's too far spiritual dualism. It's easy to get caught up in that. It's a challenge not to get caught up in it. So certainly, it's pointed out from time to time. Wow, you know, we don't want to spend our time. Look at these peppers. They look so juicy and red. Oh, that's nice, isn't it? We bite into those peppers, and there's hell to pay. Someone told me about a story. He had one of these peppers on a counter. Someone who was just like eating everything. It's one of these people who just, oh, it's food, great. Says, oh, look at that delicious red pepper. Chomp, 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 chomp. They were like for about an hour, bent over for an hour, throwing up and retching and spitting and just, you know, just absolutely wiped them out. So spiritual dualism can put on a very attractive display. That's part of its cleverness, for sure. And so they say, hey, you know, back away. But the best way to back away is to put your attention on these great teachings that we have. The Bible, as I say, phase 1. A Course in Miracles, phase 2. Journey Beyond Words, phase 3. Longchenpa's Precious Treasury, the Dharma, dot 2. Spaciousness. The Radical Dogshen of the Vajra Heart. Which we may not understand. What does that mean? You know, I don't care what it means. It's in there, you know. these terms, they just like water off my back, you know. I don't care about what term is. It's only that the pointing is there, the clarity is there, you know. These are just some Tibetan Buddhist terms. Vajra Heart. I think he sort of coined that. Heath Dow may have coined that Vajra Heart. The essential. The essential heart, the heart that is the essence that cannot be fragmented or broken, or the absolute, pure, spacious essence, heart. Vajra just means diamond or something that is, you know, immutable, unchangeable, that kind of conveying that, the immutable, unchangeable, beyond all concepts, ideation, the heart. That heart. But the thing is, we can get easily bewildered and caught up in this stuff. So I pay very little attention to any of those terms. Just breeze right through it. I get what he's saying. You see, yeah, that's all that counts. The trikaya, you know, the three qualities and stuff. Well, what, you know, fine. We get it. That's all that's important. So don't stumble over any terms. It's very important. Don't stumble over any terms. Just keep your stride going. People throw, because The spiritual dualists will throw all sorts of terminology at you to impress you. Oh, yes, they will. You could say Vajra heart, Christ heart, okay? All of this is easily translatable into the Christian tradition, absolutely, phase 1, 2, and 3. Easily translatable. As far as the Dharma dot to, you know, well. Christ consciousness, vision of oneness. It's easily, it's just simple stuff. All it's talking about is just very basic, simple stuff. It's simple, simpleness of truth. It's shorthand. It's kind of a shorthand. But the simplicity we're pointing to is even, you know, clearer than shorthand, actually. It's actually clearer than shorthand. The stance of hallucination, as I explained today, that's even clearer than the shorthand of Vajra Heart, Dharma Dhatu, Trakaya, Sambhoga Kaya, Nirmana Kaya, Dharma Kaya. It's even simpler than that, actually. It's even simpler than that. We're just holding on to this stance of hallucination through continuity fear. Right? That's what's really going on. We don't care about the six mythical realms and the ten tantra approaches and all that stuff. Yeah, all that's pointing to relevancy of the phases 1, 2, and 3, and 4. That's fine. But we're able to get to the ultimate relevancy of this stance of hallucination. And that's all it is. That's all that's going on. And our clinging to that because of our continuity fear. That's it. And then our need, pragmatic need, to evaporate this continuity fear. That's the whole situation right there. The rest of all the stuff is just elaboration. And we're getting towards the non-elaborated vision, which is the vision of oneness, as Jesus puts it. Well, he puts the vision of Christ, and also says vision of oneness, vision of oneness, vision of Christ. Christ, meaning this completely smoothed out, vast, pure space matrix, which is the ground of all being, of all appearancing. It is the ground which gives appearances their appearance. Appearances don't give themselves the appearance. It's this absence or pure emptiness, pure spaciousness, zero dimensionality that gives appearance. Okay? So this is referred to in Christian tradition as Christ. Buddhist tradition, but Vajra, the Dharma Dhatu, Dharma Dhatu. Christian shorthand, Christ. Christ is the way. There's only one. There's only one oneness. You know, Christ refers to the oneness. There's only one oneness. Of course, there's only one oneness. Now, it's very helpful in this fourth phase to be using something like this from this tradition, because the West has been bullied and buffaloed and confused and challenged by this Tibetan Buddhism, by the Eastern teachings, okay? And Christianity is somewhat sinking down into irrelevancy more and more and more as this New World religion, which is spiritual dualism, is rising to prominence now. So it's extremely helpful to be able to listen to someone who nominally was part of all that tradition, who understands it totally. It's one of the very, very top in the Buddhist tradition, one of the very highestly regarded Longchenpa. You know, supremely regarded, to be helping us out so that we can see that this teaching is no different than the teaching of Jesus Christ at all. There's no difference whatsoever. And therefore, we are not intimidated by any Eastern teaching and all the terminology and stuff like that. You can say it in any which way you want to. It's right here, right now. Right here, right now. And it's helpful that Jesus has used modern terminology in the Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, and the other voice also. Because we say, oh, Jesus can talk in modern terminology as well. Okay. So all of this is now blending into an understanding that an unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. And we're no longer trapped by all the terminology. We're no longer at war with all the elaboration and words, you see. The phase four is being beyond words. We're not trapped by any expressions, verbalization or expressions, really. Not by Christian and not by Tibetan Buddhist, neither, you see. Because we realize it's all the same, actually. And it's actually neither one nor the other. Reality is beyond all. Reality cannot be verbally expressed. It cannot. And so how can there be a correct verbal expression of reality if reality cannot be verbally expressed? That leads itself to spiritual dualism. Because then you think you need to get rid of some verbal expression that isn't the right one. And so you automatically become a crusader. Okay, you become a crusader. So you might say that all of existence, we're all simply crusaders. We've just been on this crusade, a useless, fruitless, futile crusade. And we're all crusaders, and now we're coming back from the crusade, you know, where we're limping back, you know, bloodied and bruised and deformed and crippled and tired, limping back from this horrible crusade we've been on. And we rest for a while by a very beautiful place with a beautiful spring water, and we're drinking, and we're just healing up, so to speak, just healing up. Just saying, wow, I'm not going on any more crusades, forget it. And of course, down the road, here come some more crusaders. And they say, no. And in fact, we're hiding from the crusaders. I don't want anything to do with crusaders. And we've got the rise of crusading in this world now, big time. In fact, again, the whole world is nothing but crusaders, actually, with the exception of those who have had enough. And the object of their crusade may change, they may shuffle the deck. You know, today we're crusading against this, tomorrow we're crusading against this. An unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. So wherein is the motive for any crusade? In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous, totally unnecessary, totally redundantly unnecessary. And therefore can only be motivated by the desire to maintain the stance of hallucination. There's no other possibility. Ultimately, from our severe continuity fear of fear to release, let go of the stance of hallucination, for fear that we would cease to exist if we do. So there's no need to be a crusader, none whatsoever. This is the message. Not even a spiritual crusader. Definitely not. That too is inherently released in the now. Self-released in. You could use one of the terminologies, a crusader, spiritual crusader. Liberated in the discontinuity of experience, liberated in the absence of creative fulfillment stages, liberated in non-discrimination, liberated in the all-good, liberated in the absence of hope and fear, liberated in the supreme reality, liberated in non-verbal expression, liberated in the absence of a field of thought, liberated in the middle way, liberated in the absence of any ground, liberated in the absence of any preconception, liberated in non-critical bias, liberated in its boundless transparency, liberated in thorough disinterest, liberated in its groundlessness, liberated in the discontinuity of experience, liberated in self-sufficiency, liberated in non-repression, liberated in sky-like freedom, liberated by the absence of anything to relax, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. So we're not crusaders anymore. We're not crusaders. We're liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. Liberated by crusaderness. Liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. Any attempt to liberate anything. There's no exclusions being. See, this teaching does not harbor any exclusions. Does not express any exceptions. Exception. No exceptions. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. Now in Jesus, in phase 2 and phase 3, of course, of Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, his emphasis, one of his big emphasis, is you cannot make any exceptions to this teaching. He says, this is your problem. You keep thinking that there are exceptions to truth. Truth is true and nothing else is true. There are no exceptions. He says, you must practice not making any exceptions. So here in phase 4, this presupposes you've gone through phase 1, 2, and 3, and you know there are no exceptions to truth, and you've practiced not making any exceptions. That's how you're able to full stop in the now. Because if you're trying to make exceptions, that's your mind trying, analyzing, thinking, seeking, meditating. So don't try, don't seek, don't meditate, don't analyze, don't reject, don't believe, don't trap yourself. All of that efforts are trying to say, yeah, but what about this exception? Are looking for an exception. So if you've already trained yourself and used to this, then you can full stop in the now and just say, I'm not pursuing any exception to what's being said. And of course, the history you have, the habit you have, habit, is to seek exceptions. Seek, something needs to be released. Something needs to be liberated. You know, something, I have to bring something to rest. No. This is delusion that supports the stance of hallucination. Did Longchamp have some sort of spiritual paraphernalia on him? No, none. Zero. Nothing. Nothing to indicate that he was some spiritual end being at all. He did have a tank, a white tank top on, that and with a red cross on it, a red plus sign, so to speak, which I realized lifeguard. He was on the beach. He was a lifeguard. This is how I say, recognize that you're a lifeguard. What's that mean? Guard's life. He's a lifeguard. He's a guardian of true life. Okay. Which means a guardian from spiritual dualism, which is in support of hallucination, which is in support of our desire to be the true creator of reality and displace God. So he is a guarder of our true life. He guards us, helps guard us. So if we go out swimming in the ocean and we get pulled by an undertow, you know, he is there. He's basically saying, hey, don't go out in that water. There's undertows there, severe undertows. Spiritual dualism is like an undertow. We're out swimming in a nice ocean. They think, oh, this is nice. And suddenly there's this riptide that sweeps us way out to sea. There's this undertow, you know. So the lifeguard knows the dangers of this ocean, of samsara, which is delusion, okay, which is spiritual dualism. They know the danger of that. So he had just this, the garb was that of a lifeguard. Certainly, he's aware of the dangers, yeah. So, thanks to the guardians, to the lifeguards, who, in response to our asking them, are protecting us from spiritual dualism, from the riptides of spiritual dualism. There can be some very severe riptides. And, if not for the grace of God, I would certainly have been pulled into that. If not for A Course in Miracles, Jesus, A Course in Miracles, and Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha, who has helped also with some aspect of these riptides, etc., spiritual dualism, which I've spoken at length, of how spiritual dualism can market itself in a very attractive way, in a seemingly innocent and harmless way. As I've said, the matriarchy is essentially this whole spiritual dualistic bureaucracy, which is the worshipping of nature, believing we've arisen from nature, has itself as a matriarchy and worships the feminine. Okay, the feminine is worshipped. So there are many ways that this feminine markets itself to as riptides and to pull and undertows to pull us, you know, attract us, keep ourselves bound to spiritual duality and the stance of hallucination. Very, 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 very aggressive marketing of this now in this world, extremely so. So Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma being a female appearance of a lifeguard in this world, I was able to work through a lot of those issues. Harichi helped me out with a lot of those issues, which are even more tricky, I would say. They're like the trickiest of them all. They're the worst. But then you get these sort of androgynous spiritual dualists who, you know, bisexual, androgynous, hanging freely, hanging loose, resting freely, hanging loosely, with all the spiritual accoutrements. And so then, you know, they just like really, so wow, just getting attracted to that, pulled in, trying, you know. So she helped me out with that greatly. She didn't really have much teaching. A few, just enough to know, hey, yeah, it's like the presence. Gave a lot of aphorisms that just short to the point, just like that. That's how she's viewed it. Just very clear, very simple. Work. Don't get pulled down. Work. Yeah. Says the work ethic. You know, you have to have a work ethic, so you will not get trapped by these, you know, the trickiness of spiritual duality. Don't think that you can tilt with them in verbiage, because they live in verbiage. They live in the accoutrement. They live in the acting. They live in the wardrobe. They live in the marketing. They live in the pretense. They live in the all that. That's what their focus is on. So of course they're going to be better at that than you, for sure. And so if you try to play on their terms, you're going to lose. You will lose. Which is why we need to be very humble in the mood of repentance. Very humble. As Jesus says, we need to say we are sinners. I have a very severe problem, a continuity problem, and that's it. So we're not high and mighty. We're very simple. We're very humble. Very simple. Very humble. The Holy Spirit is always with us. We're never at a loss for clarity. Never at a loss for clarity. Now the Holy Spirit will point out sometimes external help like this. Longchenpa's precious treasure, the Dharma Dhatu. The Holy Spirit will bring that into your life. But the Holy Spirit never leaves us. It's always with us. So we are always resting in that. We don't have to be some crusader for any tradition or any particular teaching or accoutrement. We don't have to be crusaders. Full stop in non-crusaderness. Full stop in non-crusaderness. As I've said, sitting quietly and still with a commitment to not jump into any crusade is the essential practice. Sri Punjaji, who received the transmission from Ramana Maharshi, they asked him, well, what's your best advice? Just sit quietly. No teaching, no teacher, no student. What he's saying is, don't be a crusader. Full stop in the now of no crusade. It's impossible. The unreleased event is impossible. Rest in that assurance. Rest in that assurance. So you may feel like, well, I'm just some little nobody in some little room in some little house with very few friends. I don't seem like I'm very spiritual. I see all these posers prancing around and they seem so, you know, wow. Look at them, say, oh, there's someone who's really spiritual. And people look at me, they don't even look at me, like I'm nothing. Nobody even knows I'm, you know, on this path of awakening, you know, and this non-dual path, this pathless path. Nobody knows, nobody can even tell, wow, I'm just a nobody. And great, keep it up. That's where it's at. As Srinasagardatta said, nobody even knows the Yani. Yani can be walking through the streets of Bombay, Mumbai. Nobody even pay him a second glance. The true Yani. No one would pay him a second glance. The true Yani. The truly realized one. Just passing by on the street. That's it. So keep in mind that your simple life is a protection from what would truly drag you down. And here, I went through a whole phase with Sri Anandamayi helped me out incredibly, actually. I went through a massive phase of all the devotional, all the high paraphernalia and accoutrement, and, you know, played this role. And then let it go. Just by myself, I just played it, so to speak. I had pandals set up and huge meetings all set up. I did the whole thing as if there was some huge spiritual situation going on where everybody said, wow, this is so intensely spiritual. And then nothing ever happened. Nobody ever came. I was able to gradually relinquish it. So I'm no longer like wondering, like, what's that about? You know, I need to do this. Do I need to do this? No, take it or leave it. Mostly leave it. All the pomp and ceremony, I set it all up myself for years and years. The wardrobes, you know, had the robes and the beads. I did everything just by myself to see, what is this like? Is this what I really want? And I said, no. This isn't where it's at. The music, everything. I sort of played the whole role. I was the guru, I was the audience, I was the media people taping it, I was the creative director making all the beautiful stuff. I was the gardener who put all the beautiful flowers everywhere. I played all those roles, did all of it myself. And then I said, wow, yeah, this isn't where it's at. That came from Sri Sri Anandamayi. She said, oh, we'll put you through this Leela of Sadhana, but a particular kind of sadhana, Leela of Sadhana, which she did at Bajetpur, which doesn't matter. Where's Bajetpur? I don't know. A little hut somewhere. It's a little city, but she was in a little hut, you know, and you see the hut and you say, what? You see the places where all this incredible stuff happened. It's just like, my God, it's nothing. It's just some little mud hut somewhere, you know, straw and mud and wow. There's nothing glamorous about it. So we did this whole trip of spiritual glamour. Whole crusade. I went through the whole crusading thing of spiritual glamour, high spiritual crusade, all this stuff. Because she knew that there would be this great pull of radical feminist matriarchy marketing of spiritual dualism. We're vulnerable to it. We're super vulnerable to this. Super vulnerable. I certainly was. And yet at the same time, I was super tired of it. So I was willing to put in the work to seem to align with it in a certain way, just so I can evaporate it. So I did go through a very wild and crazy time of of all of this. Is just like people wondering, what in the world are you doing? I have tape of it, I have video of it, I may show that to you. I've been putting some of that up on YouTube, actually. I actually taped so you can see what I was into. It was very intense. You know, you see these bearded, long-haired, these rishis, New Age rishis, and everything up there, and then the whole paraphernalia, and the entourage, and just everything in it, right? Well, I did all of that, but just by myself, and to the all nth degree, really, in a lot of ways. So I could say, oh, okay, that's, you know, all this form, spiritual form, you know, been there, done that. You want to throw like a million orchids on the stage, you know, fine, whatever. It's no big deal. And through all that flower phase, oh my God, I just had flowers set up. They're so beautiful, just unbelievable stuff. I can dig those out and you know, just you put yourself through that and you say, okay. But I did it all by myself and in the right way, you know, and just let it all go. Because spiritual dualists can also claim that they're freeing you from all that stuff. And they can put you through all this kind of stuff, too. But that's only so that your true craving to really be free of it is partially satisfied. And at the same time, you're worshiping the dualistic deities, you see, at the same time. And with Sri Sri Ananda my Ma, she was able to liberate me from all of that, too. See, she had no spiritual ego. So if you worship her, you put your attention on her, etc., there's no spiritual ego. She's only liberating you from all forms of worship to your interest in that. And then, gone. She's not even there. It's like, now I can't even get into it at all. I cannot get into it at all. Because there was never any spiritual ego involved whatsoever. Whereas the spiritual ego will put you through some crusade of getting free of spiritual ego. But what they're really saying is they want you to get free of all other lower spiritual egos, and they want to worship their spiritual ego. You see, that's their point. They can't get out of their own way. Now, Sri Sri Ananda my Ma was walking down the street. Would I suddenly say, I need to worship you, I need to do everything for you? No. I'd just be silent, probably. No desire to do anything. No desire to go on any crusade, even on her behalf. The whole crusade was on her behalf, and I found out she didn't need any crusade on her behalf whatsoever. And truth doesn't need a crusade. Truth does not need any crusade. An unreleased event is impossible. Any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. Any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. Very great. Appreciate those who have watched this, and I know it's helping. It's helping. All right. Stay humble. Don't worry if people don't view you as spiritual. We're getting help from those who are truly, what can you even say? You can't even, inexpressibly helpful, who have no spiritual ego whatsoever. As Longchenpa says, hanging loosely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything to relax. resting freely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. So we are getting help from those, from that. And that's the only spirituality we need, isn't it? All right, very great, that's it.